Can you guys see me there in Stapleton? Can you guys hear me in Stapleton? Okay, good. Excellent. All right, I guess we can go ahead and start. Today we are going to go through section 2.5 in the book. And then there's some homework assignment. There's a homework assignment from the end of chapter 2. So chapter 1 homework assignment, try to get emailed to me as soon as possible. We did go through chapter 1, right? I believe we did. We went through chapter 1, but I don't think you guys were there because of some scheduling thing. But the video for chapter 1 is available online through the email that I sent you. Did you guys get the email about Blackboard and how to get to the videos? Okay. Well, let me show you now how you can get the videos. See if I can get my computer here to work. There it goes. Can you see my computer screen there? Can you see my computer screen at all? Okay, hold on just a second. So there's my computer screen. It's actually not hard to get to the videos for the class. If you just go to YouTube, but you can also go to Blackboard following the instructions in the email. But if you go to YouTube, and search for mpcc.engineer, all one word. So, mpcc engineer, all one word, and search that. It'll bring you to a bunch of videos that I've made. And you want to look for Engineering 1000 videos. So here's Engineering 1000 August 28th, Engineering 1000 August 30th. If you click on either one of those videos, it'll take you to a playlist. And this playlist shows the videos that I've made during this class. Let's see, where is the playlist? I thought it would show the playlist, but there is a playlist. If you just go to all my videos here, there's 18 videos that I've made, apparently, not that many. And all the Engineering 1000 videos are the videos for this class. So, well, it looks like I've got three here right on the top. So this one right here is actually Wednesday's video of chapter 1. So anytime you need to go back and watch lectures that you missed or anything else, you're welcome to pick them up there. If you go to WebAssign, you will find, not WebAssign, sorry, if you go to Blackboard, you will find some other resources like the syllabus and other things like that. Now I'm going to add, do you guys have the ability to turn off your microphone there? Yeah, can you turn off your microphone, or is there a way to do that? Because I get a lot of feedback as I'm speaking, I can hear myself speak in an echo. It's kind of distracting. There we go. So give me a thumbs up if you can still hear me. Good. Okay, so that'll be much better for me, so I don't have to hear my echo all the time. If you have a question, you can just unmute your microphone and ask your question. So anyway, that is where you can get those videos on YouTube. Search MPCC Engineer, and then go ahead and find the video for the date that you missed or you want to watch again. Today we're going to go through Chapter 2. And we're going to specifically go through section 2.5. 2.1 through 2.4 are all these sections on what is an engineer, what are the engineer's responsibilities. And I think that we've pretty well covered that in studying engineering, but I want to go through some different fields of engineering and talk about them a little bit today, and explain a little bit about the history and the background of some of these engineering, similar to what you did in your assignment with the video. There's actually a lot of really interesting things to learn and to discover. And then again, there is homework from chapter 1 and chapter 2. Try to get the chapter 1 homework done as soon as possible. The chapter 2 homework will, of course, be due next Monday. Now, the new I do have a new syllabus. So let me show you my new syllabus real quick. So the new syllabus has a new schedule in it that is actually correct. Well, it's more correct anyway. So the new schedule kind of looks like the old schedule, except instead of having Tuesdays and Thursdays over here on the right-hand side, it has Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays over here. So today being the Friday the 6th, it says that we're doing 2.10, which is not true because I forgot to leave off Monday, which was Labor Day. So we're actually one day behind on this schedule, but the one that's in Blackboard, if you access that one, it is, I believe, updated to reflect the correct dates. But today we're going to do Chapter 2, Problems 3, 7, and 8, so you have three of them. Type them, send them to me, or just email the answers to me, whatever. Make sure that you use good grammar and all of that, and complete sentences. Chapter 1, there were quite a few more problems. Problems 1 through 6 and problems 9 through 11. A little more involved there. So make sure you go back and watch the video from Chapter 1, which was the September 4th video, and do those homework assignments. Get them into us. We have the end of Chapter 2, which we will do on Monday, and then we're going to do our bridge project next week. So we'll finish up the week next week with our bridge project. Give me another thumbs up if you guys both have your building kits. You should have those. No? No building kits. Okay, so we sent out, I thought that we had sent out some kits to Stapleton. That is the building kit. So there's two of those in there. There should be several Ziploc bags, and there should be essentially two sets of every Ziploc bag, and then a bundle of wood and a bundle of plastic for each of you as well. Those are your building kits. Okay. So next week, starting on Wednesday, we will start a project where we're going to build a bridge using those kits. And I will send you the instructions for that, and also some activities that you're going to do with those. essentially what it comes down to is that you're going to design and build a bridge that's going to hold a certain amount of weight, and it's going to span a certain distance. You're going to have to answer some questions about your design and do some specific things with your design. And then what I'm going to want is I'm going to want you to test the design and make maybe a video of your test or a photograph of your test or something like that. I should be able to do either of those. Most people have a video camera on their phone or whatever, so that's fine. And then you're gonna email me those results or send me those results somehow. And then you'll also send the worksheet that I give you that will explain the project and give you the directions. We'll also have some questions on it for you to answer. You'll also return that to me. You can scan it and send it to me in email, or you can send it in the mail or whatever you want to do. But that will start next week. So we'll have our first kind of short project next week. And we will spend Wednesday and Friday working on that project in class, talking about that project in class. And anything that you can't get done in class will be your homework, essentially, for next week. And then we'll start up on chapter 3. The week after next, we'll get through chapter, we'll do a little, one section in chapter 3, essentially. We'll do chapter 5. And then we'll have another project, which will be a rubber band powered car. That's a problem solving project that we're going to try to work on. Then after that, we'll do a little bit of chapter 6 and get back and get into our trebuchet project. And after that, we're just doing projects. We've only got a few weeks of book work and then all projects using the stuff that we've learned. So anybody have any questions about the modified schedule? Okay, like I said, that's available on Blackboard. Did you get an email from me?
Yeah.
Okay. So Tyler got that email as well. All right, so other things, the things that we're studying today are essentially the different fields of engineering. This is section 2.5 in your book, and I want to draw your attention to a little chart that they put in this book, which is somewhat interesting. Not terribly interesting, but somewhat. Let's see if I can zoom out a little bit here. This new document camera they have in here is terrible, but I guess that's good enough. Okay, so if you're looking in your book here on page 23, it has kind of the history of physics throughout the world, and it starts way back here at 3000 BC with civil engineering. And I'm going to actually say that's not quite true. The first type of engineering was actually biological engineering. If you go back here, over here on the left-hand side, or the right-hand side of the page, it has a biological engineering thing, and they don't do anything there. But it turns out that the first things that were truly engineered by mankind were engineered biologically. And what they were generally things like trees and grains and agricultural products. Also, animals were biologically engineered, or genetically engineered, you could think of it as, long, long time ago. And we usually call that domestication. You take a plant and you go out into the wilderness and you find the best apple tree that you can find, and you pick an apple from that tree, you pick the nicest apple from that tree, and then you use those seeds to plant a new tree. And then you take the new tree and you take the best apple off that tree and you use those seeds to plant a new tree. And what you're doing is you're choosing the best genetics that you can to create the next generation. And the first plant that is known to have been done with is the olive tree. The olive tree is thought to be the first domesticated plant, and that was done maybe as far back as 12,000 years ago. So, about 12,000 years BC, actually. So, 14,000 years ago. There's a lot of differing opinion on that, but it was a long time ago. And wheat also a long time ago, barley a long time ago, rice. These things were actually genetically engineered by using the best seeds to make the next generation of the plant even better. And that's actually how most genetic engineering is done today. Of course, we do have the ability to manipulate the genes kind of on a molecular level now, but we're still not very good at it. Most genetic engineering is done by taking the best seed from the previous generation and using that to make the next generation. So this is actually particularly relevant in Nebraska, because in Nebraska, we are an agricultural state. And there are so many different varieties of corn seed out there, and companies that make their corn seed, and they talk about genetic engineering, and most people assume that they're in some kind of laboratory, you know, splicing genes together, but they're not. Well, all they're doing is going out in the field and picking the best corn and using that for their seed. And they grow the next best corn the next year. They do some other chemical things with it as far as, you know, herbicides and pesticides and things like that. But the genetic engineering part is generally just picking the best seed for the next year. And that's why they talk about how long they've been doing it, because the longer you've been doing it, generally the better seed you get. So this map goes way back in the years in biology to the very first domesticated plants and animals. The same thing was done with animals to get the fattest goats and the fattest cows and the best milk and everything else. Same thing was done with animals. And in fact, the same thing is done with humans. It's a very natural thing. It's actually what we call evolution, right? Survival of the fittest. The most fittest animals always get together and create new animals. They don't, you know, these healthy animals don't get together with a sick animal to make their offspring. They don't mate. So it is survival of the fittest is a very natural form of genetic engineering. And humans figured that out a long time ago, long before Darwin did. So you have genetic engineering that goes way, way back, and then you have civil engineering, they say, about 3000 BC. But you could also make an argument for chemistry, chemical engineering, way back. You can make an argument for you know, cavemen that were separating clean water from dirty water, and that is essentially chemical engineering, even though it's very, very basic kind of chemical engineering. You know, cavemen that realized that they didn't want to use their water source as their latrine, and so they separated latrine from water sources, kind of like chemical engineering. But it's also kind of like civil engineering. So here they have civil engineering that goes back to 3000 BC, which essentially is the first structures that we know in prehistory that were actually designed for some purpose. Engineering does not necessarily mean just building something, and that's a very common misconception. When I give students a building kit like I've given you guys out there in Stapleton, most students just say, oh great, I'm going to take all the parts out and stick them all together and make something. That's not engineering. That's construction. Okay? You can build a house, but without an engineering plan, it's probably not going to be a very well-built house. So the engineering part is the planning, is the designing, is the deciding on what is going to be best for this building. What best materials, what best shape, what best this, what best that. That is what engineering is, and it's the same in all kinds of engineering. It's not about just doing things, it's about planning them. It's about designing them for a specific purpose and achieving that purpose through very good application. So to talk about the first civil engineering, we have to go back to the Egyptian times when they built, you know, their very large structures. You have to go back to Mesopotamia when they were building cities that were, you know, very well planned out, very well designed. You have to go back to, in the Americas, you have to go back to what are called the Anasazi, I guess they call them. The Anasazi is the, I guess the, or is it Ansa? I can't remember how I pronounce it, but anyway, that's the name for the old people in Arizona, Colorado, New Mexico, that the Navajos called them the Anasazi. But they built ancient cities, you know, thousands and thousands of years ago that were very organized, very structured, had road systems and water systems and large buildings. Go back to the Aztecs down in Mexico, the Incas in South America. These civilizations that built structures that had to be designed and had to be planned in order for them to even stand up. And of course, many of them are still standing today. The largest pyramid being in Mexico, some of the other larger pyramids being in South America and in Egypt, and so on and so forth. Roads that are still around, you know. So civil engineering is building these building these structures, building roads, building water systems, building waste systems, cities that are planned, all part of civil engineering. And then you go a little bit later, 1000 BC, and you get military engineering. Military engineering essentially started with the Greeks and then the Romans. The Greeks started inventing these engines of war, and the Romans essentially stole all these designs from them and mass-produced them and took over the world, right? So the Greeks invented the catapult. They also invented the ways of building different catapults that would hit at different distances. And so that is the beginning of military engineering, about 1000 BC here, and the Romans took that to its, you know, to its modern day, essentially. They are the modern model for a military that takes over the world. Of course, as it got more and more complicated, more and more complex with these machines, we started getting into mechanical engineering. And they put that in AD, you know, 1700. And I would actually put that much, much earlier, because there were a lot of mechanical engineering kind of things going on all during these times, which we often call the Dark Ages, which is from about, you know, 500 AD to 1500 AD, right? So there are all kinds of mechanical contraptions kind of coming to be during that time. But mechanical engineering also can go way back. You know, the first person who built a wheel, that was certainly before AD 1700. And the wheel is probably the first accomplishment of mechanical engineering, maybe the lever, you know, the lever arm for lifting a rock up. But these things do go way back. And then they put in here materials engineering at AD 1800, right? Materials engineering, where we're starting to build new materials. And again, I'm going to take this to task. The first materials engineering was actually woven fabric, and it goes way back here to the BC period. When people first started putting on clothes, when human beings first started putting on clothes, it was mostly for warmth. And they were putting on, you know, the dried skins of animals for the most part, or big leaves off of trees, or some goofy thing like that. But somebody sat down once and took some fuzz from a flax plant, or maybe from some old, you know, some ancient cotton plant or something, and they started taking the fibers off of the flowers, and they started rubbing them between their hands and rolling them into little fibers and strings and weaving them together and making cloth, which of course is probably the oldest man-made material, and it is certainly engineered. It was certainly thought out. There's certainly designing new ways to do it and new ways to use it, new ways to make it, new patterns to weave it in that were stronger, that were better, more comfortable. And they were learning to sew and do other things. So materials engineering goes way back. It's not just about, you know, modern plastics and new metals and things like this. Materials engineering goes way back. Of course, agricultural engineering, I've already talked about, is probably the earliest one. And chemical engineering probably goes way back. But we usually see these charts where they put them later on because that's when people started associating themselves as engineers. You know, they say, well, I'm an engineer and I'm doing chemistry. That means chemical engineering didn't start until I did it. And that's not really that true. And then they have here electrical engineering. Now, electrical engineering can be said to have started in the 1800s. You can't really go much before that. There was electricity was not really, you could say, discovered or understood until the early 1800s, late 1700s at the very earliest. And so electrical engineering is in the right place. But electrical engineering has changed dramatically over the years. The first electrical engineers were the people that brought electrical power to the world. But those are not the electrical engineers that we have today. They don't bring power to the world anymore. And in fact, it's pretty rare to find an engineer even in an electrical power plant, to find an electrical engineer there anyway. Most of the engineers in a power plant are going to be mechanical engineers and process engineers. But electrical engineering today has become essentially computers and gadgets and gizmos and things like that. And so it's a very changed field. Here you have aerospace engineering around 1900. And why did they put that there? Well, because the Wright brothers flew their plane in 1900. But you could put that back quite a bit as well. You could put that back into the mid-1800s, maybe even the early 1800s, when people were first starting to experiment with hot air balloons, with gliders, with kites. There were many, many engineering feats that were done long before the Wright brothers first flew their plane. In fact, the Wright brothers weren't even the first ones to fly a glider plane. They were just the first ones to use the wing design that we still use today to make a plane fly for extended flight. And they were also the first ones to do powered flight. So they did something very significant for sure, but they certainly weren't the first to kind of get off the ground for anything. Aerospace engineering, of course, has risen to all kinds of heights. No pun intended. Well, I guess there was a pun intended. Then we go down here to computer engineering. Of course, computer engineering, they are going to put down here in the middle of the 19th century, or the 20th century, middle of the 1900s again. Not quite true. The first computer was actually invented and patented long before that, 100 years almost before that, back in the 1800s. But it was not an electrical computer, it was a mechanical computer. And nobody could make it work. They couldn't make the parts fine enough to make it work. But just recently, in the past 20 years, I think, somebody actually went back to the original patent for the original computer, the first computer ever. It was a mechanical device that used wheels and gears and things like this to compute mathematics, to do some addition, basic addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division. And they built this old computer from way back in the 1800s, and it works, and it's on now on display in a science museum in Europe somewhere. But the first computer engineering was certainly done 100 years before the first computer. And the first computer, you may be surprised to know, was actually, you know, back in the 1940s, the first electronic computer. And back in the 1940s, a computer would take up an entire building, because it wasn't about microchips, it was about big tubes, they're essentially big diode tubes, you could think of them as, if you know what a diode is. But each of these tubes was like a big light bulb, you know, maybe 10 inches high sometimes, these big light bulbs. And each light bulb was like a little circuit in the computer, a little part of a microchip. So each microchip would take up an entire big room, you know, full of these light bulbs. And the light bulbs were hot. They were always lit up all the time and really hot. And when you got a bug in your computer, it was literally a bug. You'd have to go through and take a moth out of the computer because it got stuck between two light bulbs and created a short. And that's where the term debugging a computer came from. Nowadays, when you debug a computer, you're looking for a problem in the software or something in the settings that's goofed up, right? And then, of course, they have some of these things here, a branch off of chemical engineering, which is biochemical engineering. Again, I would put that a lot earlier. And then nuclear engineering. Now, nuclear engineering is definitely a new thing. The nuclear sciences weren't really discovered until about 1900, when they first discovered X-rays coming off of uranium ore. And so the 1900s, nuclear engineering, or nuclear science was discovered, and nuclear engineering was kind of brought online. In the United States, when they built the first nuclear reactor at, was it Boston College, I think? Can't remember where it was. I think it was in Boston. But anyway, it was Chicago. But anyway, they made the first nuclear pile, they called it, because it was a big pile of graphite blocks to control the heat. And they had a nuclear reaction creating lots and lots of heat. And then, of course, from there, the same people designed the nuclear bomb, and then it's gone all kinds of places from there. And the very last one that they have here is biomedical engineering. And notice all these lines they have connected to these things. You know, electrical engineering, computer engineering are all connected to chemical engineering and biotechnical or chemical engineering through biomedical engineering, right? And biomedical engineering is essentially a combination of a bunch of fields to improve medical practices, medical devices, medical equipment, medical treatment, all kinds of things in the medical field. And so that is that is a field that has actually also been around quite a long time. It's just not been called biomedical engineering. The first person who invented a splint to hold somebody's arm in place so that their arm would heal properly and they'd be able to use it again is that's biomedical engineering. That goes way back. So biomedical engineering, again, another very old engineering field, even though it's only been named biomedical engineering recently. So just a lot of engineering fields out there. There are so many of them, and like I said, this chart I don't think is very accurate. It doesn't really tell the whole story about engineering. Excuse me. Let me change to my computer really quick. Got to, let's see, where am I? Goodness gracious. Okay, just give me some time to bring something up here so we can finish off this section. Okay, so hopefully this will give us what we're looking for. And let's get on to the right thing here, the right input. So what we're going to do now is we're going to take a look at just lots of different fields of engineering. You've of course already seen some of these as you've done assignments, but we're going to look at all kinds of different kinds of engineering and get a feel for what there is out there in engineering. What are the possibilities, right? Yes. The bottom left half, okay, I'll move it around here and see what you can get. Let's see, bottom left half, so I need to move it down a bit. Oops, oh my. Oops, that's not working. So is that better? Okay. Sorry about the microphones hanging down in the way. They designed this room poorly. But what do we do, right? What do we do? Okay, so anyway, so to differentiate between engineers and scientists, we say that scientists discover things and engineers create things, right? So the scientists are out there to figure out what's going on in nature, to figure out how it works, to learn new things, to explain and describe things with mathematics. And then the engineers take those discoveries, those mathematics and those descriptions and all that information and understanding, and they work with it to make things so that we can do what we do in the world, which is live and whatever else, right? All the stuff that we do during our lives. And the possibilities are endless. The more that the scientists discover, the more the engineers can do with it. And so many people say, well, why do we give so much money to these scientists just to go play around in the lab to figure out things? What is the use of their discovery? People are always asking that question. People all over the world. I mean, we give $1 million to some guy in Colorado to study atoms in a laboratory with lasers. And we say, well, what is the application? What are you going to do with it? Are you going to sell it? And the scientist says, well, no, I'm just studying it. And you say, well, we're going to stop giving you money. That's stupid. It's absolutely stupid policy because they're the ones that are collecting the information that the engineers make money with. The engineers take that information, they go out there and they create cell phones, and they go out there and they create plastic, and they go out there and they invent, you know, bulletproof glass, and they do all kinds of things that make our world what it is. And without the scientists, the engineers have no information, they have nothing to work with, no tools. So you need both sides of it, but they are quite different in what they do. Here they have another comparison of science versus engineering. In science, they do a lot of analysis, a lot of observation, right? Most of all, they observe first, and then they analyze their observations. They create theories. They're doing lots of things, right? In engineering, they're integrating things together. They're producing things, right? They're looking at problems in the world and trying to solve them. They're looking for things that they can invent that are completely new to the world. Something that is not part of nature that we're going to make for ourselves to make our lives better. Right? But there are tons of different fields, just tons of different fields, so many different places we can do. The five largest, of course, are chemical, civil, electrical, industrial, and mechanical. And even within these five large fields, there are many, many different types of fields out there. So let's take a look at some of them. Aerospace engineering, right? These engineers deal with space and also things that fly in the atmosphere. So not just space engineering, but aerodynamics engineering inside of the atmosphere. Sometimes they split that up, and they may actually split it up in here. I don't know if they do. Sometimes they call it aeronautical engineering, which is just the stuff in the atmosphere, and then aerospace engineering, which is just out in space. But they do so many different things, so many different things. I have a friend who is an aerospace engineer, and he tests satellites for space debris collisions. So essentially, anything that's floating around the Earth gets hit by little pieces of space dust and space particles and radiation. And his job is to test these satellites before they go into space to make sure that they can withstand that bombardment, withstand the abuse that they're going to put up. And it's actually kind of cool work. He gets to break things for a living, right? I have another friend who it works for Lockheed Martin, which is one of the biggest aerospace companies in the world. And they build communication satellites. They build most of the spy satellites, for example, and that's what he specifically works on. But they also built these great planes like the SR-71, which was the big spy plane of the Cold War. And it was such a cool plane because it could fly so much higher. It flew so high you had to wear a spacesuit while you were in it. And it flew so fast that it actually increased its length by like 2 feet while it was flying because it got so hot while it was flying so fast. I think it still holds the speed record for an airplane in the United States Air Force. Then we go on to biomedical engineering, which of course we've talked about a little bit, but biomedical engineering encompasses a lot of stuff as well, just like aerospace engineering. There are people out there that are creating microchips that you can put a blood sample on, and the microchip will analyze the blood for 50 different things all at once. Instead of having to do 50 different tests and take 50 different blood samples, you just take a drop of blood and it just does everything all at once. And there are people that build artificial legs and artificial hearts and design new ways for helping people who are blind or who are deaf. They design new heart monitors. They design the hospital beds that they're using in the hospital. A lot of design goes in those beds, and they're expensive because of all that design that goes into them to make it easier to treat the patient and also to make the patient heal better. There are specific things that they design into those beds for very specific reasons. Also, biomedical engineering includes things like sports. A lot of sports engineering is done by biomedical engineers, sports braces and sports implements. So lots of stuff going on there. Chemical engineering is a big one these days, and there's a lot of money involved. Everything from new chemicals to new drugs to microchips, because all microchips are doped or soaked with chemicals, to working in a chemical factory of some kind, doing processes. There's just so many things done with chemicals these days that chemical engineering is just a huge field. Of course, civil engineering is, if it's built, it's a civil engineering project, right? Here they have a picture of a huge dam that's expelling a lot of water at the bottom of it. I don't know if that's an accident or if that's on purpose. But big dams are designed to release a lot of water. So, but if you've ever had a chance to go to a large engineering project, a large civil engineering project, it's worth going to see because they're pretty impressive. Closest one to here for a civil engineering project would probably have to be maybe one of the stadiums in Denver. The new stadium in Lincoln, actually. What do they call it? Memorial Stadium? They just rebuilt that and and it was a big civil engineering project. There's a lot of stuff involved in that project. And if you ever have a chance to tour the field, go down on the field and see and go down and feel the field turf or whatever they call that stuff. That is the weirdest field. If you ever have a chance to do it, it's worth it because it's got all kinds of layers of different materials underneath this astroturf kind of stuff that make it feel much more like real grass, even though it's not. And it's a really interesting field to walk on and to get a tour of, because they'll talk about all the engineering that goes into that. Computer science and engineering. So computer science or computer engineering, it's all about computers, it's all about software, right? So lots of stuff going on there. Of course, computers changed a lot during my lifetime, but they haven't changed much in the past 5 to 10 years. But there will be a big change in computers, and I don't know when it will happen, but it will happen. There are so many different things going on out there in the science world that are leading to new ways to do computers, and we'll see some of them soon. Environmental engineering, keeping water, air, and soil healthy, right? So environmental engineering is all about taking good care of our planet and using our resources well. And that tends to be a very highly politically charged field, but it's still important whether or not however you feel about, you know, the environment or whatever politically, it's still an important field because we do need to use our resources well so that we can be very efficient. And, you know, efficiency essentially leads to good living in many ways, not the least of which not being money. You know, if you're efficient, you make more money. That's important to everybody. Electrical engineering, of course, we've talked about that a bit. Lots of stuff going on there. Mechanical engineering is a biggie. It is probably the biggest area of engineering of them all because it is the broadest thing. If it has a moving part in it, it requires a mechanical engineer to design it. And there's not much out there that doesn't have moving parts. I have a computer that is the state of the art, the latest, greatest computer there is. It has everything in it. It's a solid state device. There are no moving disk drives. Everything is just beautifully top of the line stuff. And yet it still has a fan in it. It still has a fan in it. It still has keys that move. It still has a screen that has to swivel up. And so a mechanical engineer still had something to do with it. And not only that, but fitting all those parts into that tight space took a mechanical engineer as well. And so mechanical engineers work on every single project. If it has any moving part at all, mechanical engineers are a part of it. Petroleum engineering. This is huge right now, very close to home. There is a ton of money coming down out of South Dakota in the form of oil. And petroleum engineers are up there taking oil out of the ground where we couldn't take it out before. And we told them they could do this. Scientists, you know, science told engineers they could do this 40 years ago, 30 years ago. My dad was on the project back in the 70s and the 80s. They told them, you can take the oil out of this shale, but it took the engineers a while to make the process efficient enough and cheap enough, and it also took the country a little while to decide that it was worth it because gas is getting more and more expensive. But now we are taking lots and lots of oil out of the oil shale up there. Essentially, oil shale is just the Rocky Mountains. I mean, that's what it is. Rocky Mountains are made out of rock that's soaked with oil. We just had to figure out a way to get it out of the rock, to unsoak it, you could think, say, and so that we can use it. So petroleum engineering is a huge deal and a huge ton of money. Lots of jobs in that right now. Let's take a look a little bit at salaries in engineering. This is back in 2005. And in 2005, engineering was kind of a little bit higher than it's been. And so engineering salaries have not gone up a lot. They've maybe gone up a little bit. But here you're seeing across the spectrum, you know, upper 40s, there's only one thing in the lower 40s. And we got a lot of stuff in the lower 50s. And even some stuff in the 60s for just a bachelor's degree. So we're talking your four-year degree, 4 or 5 years of schooling, you're getting a $50,000 paycheck out of college. That is so much higher than every degree out there. Believe it or not, it's higher than a medical degree. You get your medical degree and your first year as an intern will not pay this much. Okay, you're going to get much less pay actually. It's going to take you a couple of years. With a medical degree to start making more than this. After that, you make a lot more than this. But if you have a master's degree, it bumps it up $5,000 to $10,000 more. You know, maybe even a little bit more than that. $5,000 to $15,000 more, you could say. With a PhD, it's another $10,000 on top of that. So it depends on how much time you want to put into your schooling and what degree you go into. Because in some degrees, you don't really have master's degrees or PhDs available, but in most of them you do. But it's a well-paying job. And the great thing about it is that for you engineers now, there is a big shortage of engineers who are native to the United States. And many engineering jobs out there require that you be a natural-born citizen or at least a naturalized citizen of the United States. Because a lot of engineering jobs, you're working for the government. And you have to have certain types of clearance. Maybe you're working for the Department of Energy, a lot of classified stuff going on in the Department of Energy, or the Department of Defense, which is, you know, all about the military, so you have to be a citizen. And we're very short on engineers for that. Some of the coolest jobs out there are actually in the military for engineers. You can be a mechanical engineer in the Army. You can be a civil engineer in the Army, a chemical engineer in the Army. You can do all those things. You can be an electrical engineer in the Army. And you can do all those things in the Navy and in the Air Force. And guess what? They will pay for your schooling. They'll pay for you to get your degree in these engineering fields. And then you'll automatically have a job when you finish college. You'll be in the military. So you'll have to be in the military for, I think, 4 years after college or something like that. But you don't go into the military as some kind of grunt worker. You go into the military as an upper level officer. Usually you go in as at least a lieutenant and sometimes as a sergeant major or a major as an engineer. So you're going in at a high pay rate and you're not working as a grunt with a shovel on, you know, digging some ditch somewhere. You're working as a professional in the military. And some of it is just really cool work. For example, being a nuclear engineer in the Navy, you can be a nuclear engineer there, and there they get to work on the nuclear power plants on submarines and cruisers and aircraft carriers, all these and these missile boats that are all nuclear powered. It's really quite cool work to work with that kind of technology. I always thought that if I went into the military, working on a submarine would be kind of cool. It's kind of a cool job. You have to be not claustrophobic and be able to stay on a small ship for months at a time, but still, it's a very interesting job. So, when do engineers work? You know, most engineering jobs are normal kind of job times, but oftentimes it depends on what kind of engineering you're in. If you're a mechanical engineer in a power plant, there's always a mechanical engineer on duty at a power plant, so sometimes you're going to pull weird hours. But most of the time, it's normal stuff. However, almost all engineers have deadlines to meet, and when you're, you know, 2 days away from your deadline, you might be pulling two 24-hour days in a row. That just happens. But you generally get overtime, and it's usually pretty good overtime. So, good stuff. How long do you have to go to school? Most engineers are in school for at least 5 years, okay? And they say here a few engineering programs take 5 years, but most of them take 5 years nowadays to get your bachelor's degree because almost all engineers have to now take electronics courses and computer courses because computers and electronics are a part of every type of engineering nowadays. So that adds on essentially an extra year. But if you go summer times and you work hard and get lots of stuff done, you can get it done in 4 years. A lot of people do. And then how do you become an engineer? Well, you're going to have to get an engineering degree these days. A lot of engineering fields, for example, in electrical engineering and civil engineering, they get what is called a professional engineering license, PE. Particularly in civil engineering, this is important. My brother has one of these. If you don't have your PE license, you'll never become the boss. You'll always be the peon in the company. So there are lots of resources out there. You can go to engineeringk12.org, or you can go to engineering.com, or you can go to any number of engineering schools and learn about engineering. We've talked about that before, so I won't talk about it anymore. But what I want you to do at this point is I want you to go and get your homework done for Chapter 1 and the first part of Chapter 2, and then we'll come back and revisit the end of Chapter 2 on Monday. So does anybody have any questions before we're done here? All right. Well, you guys have a great day, a great weekend, and we'll see you on Monday.